Today, we explore the myth of the Titanic. I'm your host, Ryan Socash, and you're watching It's History. There can be no one who clicked this video and has not already heard about the Titanic. And there can be no one among them equally certain who does not already know how the story of the Titanic ends. This is, when we think about it, really quite remarkable, as there's no one alive today who actually remembers the Titanic. All the survivors have passed. For the rest of us, there is very little possibility that the disaster had directly affected us personally or historically. And yet, we have passed the 100th anniversary of the sinking on April 15th, 1912, nearly a decade ago. The world is still obsessed. And we hear the repeated exhortation, remember the Titanic, even though not one of us literally can. And yet, if you ask people, they will tell you not just about the iceberg, but probably also about the lifeboats, women and children first, or the band playing, Nearer My God to Thee, as the ship finally sank with the loss of some 1,500 lives. The captain, of course, went down with the ship. But most of all, they will tell you about the unsinkable ship, the biggest and finest ship ever built, the last word in luxury that sank seemingly inevitably on its first and only voyage. They said that God himself could not sink this ship, but on her maiden voyage, she was doodly ripped apart. There are two remarkable things about this. First, that a 100-year-old story continues to be told and retold. Second, that many of the component stories are simply not true. And foremost, among these is the big one, that prior to the departure from Southampton, the Titanic was hailed by all as the unsinkable ship. It wasn't. So how do we explain this? The answer is that 100 years on, the sinking of the Titanic has long since passed from history into myth. In the common parlance, a myth is a falsehood, or at least an enduring popular misconception. But intellectually, a myth is much more complex. A myth is more accurately a story that may or may not be historically true, but which contains a series of cultural thrusts embedded in narrative form. In this way, it may, like a fable, not be true in the literal sense, but we can still say there's a lot of truth in that story. If you look a step further, you'll find that the content of the story both tends to be thinner and crucially serves to make sense of an otherwise seemingly random universe. This is precisely the case with the Titanic. Myths are not limited to distant, past, exotic, or primitive people, and the Titanic is just such an evolving modern myth that we can really understand how stories develop over time. Let's start in the cinema. Films about the Titanic typically make great claims for their accuracy, but in reality, part very quickly from the historic record. Starting with the infamous Nazi Titanic film of 1943, for example, this film had the audacity to invent and place a German officer on board, who proceeded to give dire warnings to the British crew about the reckless inefficiency of it all. Inevitably, it was he who spotted the iceberg first and lived to give damning evidence at the official inquiry, but not before he had rescued a small child from her watery grave. Then we have a film titled Titanic from 1953. Hollywood's first Titanic feature showcased an entirely fictitious American family in pursuit of solid Midwestern values. Well, Britain's A Night to Remember in 1958 is about class as much as it's about the steamship. Lou Grade's Raise the Titanic in 1980 was fun, but as far from reality as a Star Wars film. Then there's James Cameron's multi-award-winning Titanic of 1997. On the other hand, it made great claims for the historic authenticity, but centered upon a totally invented core of characters, none of whom ever existed. We are left, however, with a warm glow of personal fulfillment, cross-class possibilities, the so-called pleasure of being poor, and most of all, true love beyond any price. If finally we cross into television, Julian Fellowes' 100th anniversary Titanic miniseries is a well-shaken cocktail of actual and imaginary characters who interact as if nothing impossible in fact were taking place. When we study popular culture representation of the Titanic in whatever medium in close-up, we see the values of the culture, era, and society that made them in vivid reflection. The Titanic sinks consistently in the popular imagination, but the values that go down with it remain many and varied according to the particular perspectives of the tellers of the tale in both time and space. So in addition to the particular and local variations, we need to stand back and take stock of the overwhelming universal themes. Consistent among all versions of the myth of the Titanic is the notion of the vessel as the unsinkable ship, which sank on her maiden voyage. No version of the myth is complete without this fundamental ingredient, and it is an ingredient which will be more than familiar to students of classical mythology as the reworking of the Hellenic themes of hubris and nemesis. In Greek mythology, hubris is pride, usually that of man overreaching himself in the face of the gods. This is especially the case when man seeks to overcome nature, which is God's rightful domain. We can imagine, then, the mythical consequences of building a ship which God himself could not sink. But here's the vital point that is missed in pretty much every retelling of the myth of the Titanic. No one really called the Titanic unsinkable until after the ship had sunk. The Titanic's alleged unsinkability was essentially a post hoc popular culture invention to provide a moral and a meaning to the terrible but ultimately random event. In this way, the historic Titanic became mythical within days of sinking, and this is a fact that plays second fiddle to the culturally preferred version. To substantiate this point, we must remember that the Titanic was in fact the second of three almost identical sister ships constructed by the White Star Line. The eldest was the Olympic, which preceded the Titanic into service on just the same route, with precisely the same safety features. But the Olympic did not sink, and so was never dubbed unsinkable. The Titanic, on the other hand, went down, and so the myth got to work, offering an explanation for the disaster, an explanation that would have made perfect sense in classical and cultural forebears. Over 100 years on, therefore, our continued fascination with the Titanic reminds us that myth, unlike the actual Titanic, is alive and well today. To offer some context on the contrast between the myth and the reality, I've linked two first-hand survivor accounts to this video, so make sure you check them out, subscribe to Its History, and I will see you again next week.